again. Our guest today had the dubious honor of singing an aria from Pagliacci, a mere shed bedlam in Madison Square Garden. Better known facts about him are that he starred on Days of Our Lives for 14 years, was a regular on the legendary A Show of Shows, and had the hit recording of Davy Crockett. He is, of course, the popular Bill Hayes. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Lowe.
Bill Hayes, June 5th.
June 5th, that's
right. Harvey, Illinois.
Harvey, Illinois.
Great place to come from. Illinois.
Illinois.
Outside of Chicago?
Yes. Lou Boudreau grew up right across the street. Tom Dreesen's from Harvey. Small town, but it's a suburb of Chicago.
Tell me, when did Bill Hayes decide to become a singer? At what age?
Well, Bill Hayes grew up singing.
Really?
I mean, I was in a musical family, and we sang all the time. Around the piano, or in the shower, or anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
We just sang all the time. So singing was a part of my life. I played fiddle through high school, played pretty nice fiddle. Learned good musicianship there. But I never knew that you could make any money singing. It never occurred to me. I mean, singing was what we did for fun, and acting for fun. And when I finally, I graduated from college in 1947, and I fell into a job singing and acting in the chorus of Carousel, Chicago, Schubert Theater, and getting paid $60 a week. And I thought, hey, man, this is for me. I don't want to do a real job. And fortunately, I've never had to.
Olson and Johnson.
Olson and Johnson.
Funs and Poppins, or Popsons and Funs?
Funs and Poppins.
Tell me about that. I was in Chicago when that came out, I think. It started in Chicago, didn't it?
Yes, yes.
It did?
That was 1949. We played Chicago Stadium.
You did?
Yes.
I remember that show.
Played
Olson and Johnson.
Huge arena-type buildings.
Uh-huh.
I was with them for about a year. And we played Madison Square Garden. We played the Indianapolis Coliseum. Just whopper places,
right,
you know.
Right,
instead
right.
of one cow, there'd be six cows or whatever. Everything was multiplied.
Did you have fun in that show, Olson and Johnson's? You were very young, you know. I mean, you're a boy singer. You did you had to do bits too, skits and all that.
Yes, all their bits. I was a stooge and a singer, production singer. Certainly, I was getting paid for performing. That was, I mean, that was to me incredible.
How did you get Sid Caesar's show? That's the show of all shows.
Your show of shows was the best series ever been on.
On television, yes.
That's right. Well, as I said, I was with Olson and Johnson for about a year.
Right.
We played nightclubs, we played vaudeville, we played presentation houses. We also did a series of 13 television shows replacing Milton Berle. At that time, Milton Berle was Mr. Television.
Right.
He was the king.
Right.
And we replaced him through the summer of 49.
Right.
Max Liebman saw me on that show and called me and said, would you come? I'm putting a show together. It's going to be called Your Show of Shows. Would you come sing for my writers and me? And I did. He said, would you come be on our show? And he was only going to pay me about a third as much as I was making on on Olson and Johnson. Olson and Johnson said, you don't want to do that. I mean, we're, you know, Olson and Johnson,
right.
we're going to pay you three times that at least. But something told me this was the place to go. It was Show of Shows was the best group of talented people ever
the
put
best,
together.
Yes. Do you remember, Bill Hayes, the song that you did that day for to audition for that
yes.
show? Do you remember?
Yes.
Do you remember the, because that's the song that really, do you remember at all of the song you did?
What I sang for Max Liebman?
I sang,
he said he wanted to hear a ballad, and I didn't know what a ballad was. And I sang some crazy Irish song that I thought was an Irish ballad.
Danny Boy-like or something like that?
It was
like
a Danny Boy type.
That's, but Sid Caesar, working with Sid Caesar, what a great honor.
Such a sweet, charming creature was Kitty O'Toole, the lily of fair Tipperary, with her cheeks like a rose and her eyes like the sloes, and her figure as neat as a fairy. I saw her one day, she looked like a queen, in the glory of sweet 21. She sat with McGinty's big arm round her waist. Be dad, how I envied McGinty. That was the song.
That's the song? Great.
It was not a ballad, but in my mind then, it was a ballad.
Sid Caesar, Working with Sid Caesar, Imogene Coco.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. God, what masters.
Incredible.
Yes.
Sid was a fountain. They both were.
Uh-huh.
I mean, a fountain of creativity.
Right.
Never stopped. Just a continuous fountain.
Uh-huh.
Didn't like it this way, switch the gear, mm-hmm. one notch, play it a totally different way, just as funny, just as creatively. Uh-huh. Don't like that? Okay, switch it again, uh-huh. do it a different way. Fabulous.
But you had a live audience out there.
Yes, we did.
That show was live.
Yes, it was live. It was all live.
All
90
live.
Minutes, every week, every Saturday night. It was all live. We did play to an audience of about 350.
Mm-hmm.
And because it was live, many things happened. You know, live television,
like.
It just...
Yeah.
Well, on our very first show, we had Yasha Heifetz as a guest star.
Right.
And they made, unfortunately, they put him at the end of a half hour.
Right.
And NBC had said to us, now you can go 9 to 9:30, but you got to stop exactly at 9:30.
Right.
And take a break. Then you can go 9 to 10, 9:30 to 10, and you have to take a break exactly at 10.
Uh-huh.
And another one exactly at, you're off at 10:30.
Right.
Okay. Well, they put him right at the end. They made him the last act of the first half hour.
Uh-huh.
And I can never forget the look on his face when the stage manager came out. It had run too long and some
right.
of the other things. And they came out and said, Mr. Heifetz, sir, excuse me, you're done. That's it. And he's still playing. Oh. So from then on, we were the members of the company
uh-huh.
came in, did the last of the half hour. And many times, Charlie Sanford, conducting the orchestra, would hold up his hand and say, hey, we're behind, here we go, and we'd do something very
So it was really
fast.
Tough those days to do a live show with a live audience and millions of people are watching you. You know,
absolutely.
Today it's easy. They tape it.
They tape it, that's
they
right.
Tape.
And
Johnny Carson's taped.
That's
I know,
right.
You know.
And if they run an hour and a half plus 5 minutes,
right.
all they have to do is just find where they want to cut 5 minutes.
Yeah, right.
But we couldn't do that.
Imogene Cook.
Yes. Delightful
I
lady.
I love her. Wonderful
Delightful.
Talent. Yeah. Sid Caesar had some problems on the shows, lots of mental problems at the time when he was doing his show because he was such a genius and such... Am I right, Bill?
Yes, I would say so. He became such a fabulous star so
right.
quickly that in his book... which is autobiographical, mm-hmm. he's just said he just could not handle it well. I thought he handled it quite well, but apparently in retrospect he went to pills and booze and gave himself a rough time trying to balance his life.
Right.
That he was very emotional about his shows.
He was caring
a show.
Yes.
And had a lot of burden on his shoulders.
Uh-huh.
People today seeing comedy don't realize how fabulously funny those people were. Sid Caesar, Imogene Coca, Carl Reiner, Howard Morris, the four of them
yes.
were just so brilliant. Uh-huh. Plus the writers writing for...
Yeah, the best writers.
Yes. Mel Tolkien, Mel Brooks, Lucille Callan, Tony Webster, they just wrote everything. Mel Brooks.
Uh-huh.
Was not hired by Max Liebman.
Oh, he wasn't?
No. Max thought Mel was trashy.
Right.
No, not enough class. Well, Sid brought him in,
uh-huh.
and Sid says, he's funny, Max. He writes funny. So Max says, well, you pay him. So Sid brought Mel Brooks in.
Is that what
to
happened?
Start. And, of course, Mel was wonderfully creative. He used to write all the monologues that Sid used to do, you know, when he played a gum machine and
uh-huh.
a fly on the wall
uh-huh.
and a little uh-huh. baby. Mel would write those.
Remember the Jack Parr days?
Certainly.
Those were the days.
Yes.
You have appeared on that show many times.
I appeared on the Jack Parr
Tell
show.
Me about Jack Parr, though, Bill. I mean, a lot of people really don't know Jack Parr, but I guarantee you do. Tell me about Jack Parr.
Well, he's a very unique talent, certainly. He was a very real person,
mm-hmm.
and what he thought, he could not conceal.
That's what it was.
Came
when you saw Jack Parr, you saw it.
That's right. He was not a fake in any way.
So when he cried, he actually...
He cried.
He meant it.
When he laughed, it was not a put-on. He just had conversations with his people.
Uh-huh.
One show I did with him, his guest was Errol Flynn. And Errol Flynn had just been down fighting on Castro's side.
I remember that. Yes.
And he was very moving, and Jack Parr was quite moved by Errol Flynn's statements, the things that he believed in. Mm-hmm. He suddenly realized that Errol Flynn was not just an actor, but a but
a human
thinker,
being,
a believer, and a human being.
Uh-huh.
That show, if you happen to remember that show, that was Phyllis Diller's first performance.
Was that Phyllis's first performance?
Yep.
She came from the village at the.
That's right.
She was working at the Bonsoir. That's right. Is that right?
That's right. And that's right.
I do remember that.
She didn't even have any costumes yet. She was wore
a housewife,
a black leotard with a top, kind of like what you have, and she was just housewife, just starting.
And the audience took for her.
Yes.
She became just an overnight success.
A wonderful
Jeff Carr really made a lot of stars, didn't he?
Yes, Genevieve.
Genevieve. Yeah. Yes, you're absolutely right. Getting back to Sid Caesar.
Yes.
Sid Caesar's show. That was on the air for how many years, would you say?
Started in 1950, ran until 1954. There were 169 episodes,
really?
Performances of your show of shows.
Uh-huh.
And the cast not only was good comedically, but musically.
Right.
We had Robert Merrill.
Wonderful singer.
Was singing at the Met at the time. Nobody ever sang better. We had Marguerite Piazza.
Right.
Likewise, she was singing at the Met, and she sang gloriously.
Uh-huh.
We had Jack Russell, a terrific baritone. Mm-hmm. Judy Johnson, who still sings beautifully. Mm-hmm. We had the Billy Williams Quartet. We had the Hamilton Trio.
Right.
We had Mata and Hari, the dancers.
Yes.
And every time we had a guest star, and we had guest vaudeville acts.
Uh-huh.
You know, they used to put on, Max Liebman loved vaudeville, and he'd have something funny, and then he'd have opera, and then he'd have something funny, and then he'd have a piece of vaudeville nonsense, you know.
Today, our television is not that way, like it's so entertaining.
No, it's different.
Bill, what's happening with our television today? I mean, I'm turning television on, and it's not entertaining me like when I was a kid growing up. Like the Ed Sullivan, I understand they're going to bring even the Ed Sullivan shows repeats back. They're going to put them on the air again, because people got to be entertained.
They certainly
Everything
could.
Is vulgarity today, and it's aiming to sex. Everything in America is sex.
Yes, I mean, and people don't have a chance to warm up and develop their craft. I mean, when I was working with Olson and Johnson, Our opening act was the Clark Brothers.
Uh-huh.
Two fellas, tap dancing team. They started as kids, and they worked in New York, and they got better.
I know who they are.
Better, and they got better, and they got better, and they were just the most fabulous.
Black boys.
Yes.
Two black
yes.
boys. I worked in Pittsburgh with them.
They're
fantastic.
Great.
Yes.
They've been
I
working
they
in
are.
Europe for the last 30 years.
Yes,
did you know that?
Yes, I know.
Well,
I worked in Europe with them, too.
Yes?
Yes, Bill. Uh-huh.
Interesting thing, last week I filmed a cop rock,
which
will be on October 24th, I believe.
Uh-huh.
And the choreographer was Russell Clark.
Uh-huh.
And he said, my dad's one of the Clark brothers.
Brothers.
I said, whoa,
uh-huh.
I worked with them for a year.
Uh-huh. Isn't that great?
Yes.
They've been in Europe working a lot. They're very, very good. Bill, tell me about your Broadway show. Then you went to Broadway.
Yes, I worked in Me and Juliet.
Me and Juliet.
Certainly.
That was your first Broadway show.
Yes.
That's Roger.
Rogers and Hammerstein.
Uh-huh.
One of the thrills that anyone could ever experience.
Uh-huh.
I auditioned for them. I auditioned again for Rogers and Hammerstein and George Abbott.
Uh-huh.
And I took a leave of absence from your show of shows to go perform in Me and Juliet.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And, oh my, what a thrill. I can remember Dick Rogers called one day and said, could you come by my apartment on Sunday? I'm going to play through the score before we go into rehearsal.
Uh-huh.
Well, what a thrill that was.
Uh-huh.
He played through the score for us. Oscar, the first day of rehearsal, took his script and he said, this is the script as I have written it.
Uh-huh.
But I want you to know that George Abbott is the director and any change he makes is right.
Uh-huh.
Well, I thought that was a pretty healthy thing for a writer to say. that here's my baby, but I give it to.
Right.
And of course, Abbott was great. Well, we ran 15 months.
15 months? Who was in the show with you?
I played opposite Isabel Bigley.
Bigley, uh-huh.
Ray Walston, my favorite
Ray
Martian.
Walston, my favorite. I interviewed Ray.
Yes.
Fun guy.
Yes.
Fun guy.
And in the chorus?
Uh-huh.
Shirley MacLaine.
Shirley MacLaine was in the chorus?
In the dancing chorus.
Uh-huh.
Shirley Jones.
Really?
Enzo Stuarti. Carol Lawrence.
Wow. This is Juliet.
Me and Juliet.
Me and Juliet.
Yes.
That was Shirley MacLaine in the chorus there.
Yes, it was.
How interesting.
Yes, and she went from that into a pajama game.
Uh-huh.
And that was the fabled time when Carol Haney, she was understudying Carol Haney.
Uh-huh.
Carol Haney
right.
hurt her ankle.
And she subbed in.
And Shirley MacLaine went in and was seen and into movies just like that.
Uh-huh.
Still the wonderful actress, performer.
Uh-huh.
I'm so thrilled.
Then what happened to Bill Hayes' career after Broadway? Then where did Bill Hayes go?
Ballad of Davy Crockett.
Ah, that's it. You got your gold records.
Yes,
Davy Crockett, you sold more records than ever that time of the year.
It was a good record. I recorded with MGM Records from 1950 to 54. And then I stopped with MGM Records. Uh-huh. My best record there had been High Noon. Do not forsake me, oh my darling. And Archie Blyer had left Arthur Godfrey and started his own record company.
Uh-huh.
And we met, and he said, if I get a song, would you do a record with my company? I said,
right.
Yes, I would. And a few weeks later, he called, and he said, I got it.
Uh-huh.
Come on by.
Uh-huh.
We cut it that night, one take. That was it.
That was it.
One take.
One take.
Off like that. Fabulous.
Uh-huh.
It's a good song.
Arthur Godfrey.
Yes.
Tell me about him.
I worked with Arthur only on Hollywood Squares. I enjoyed him as a performer a lot.
Uh-huh.
And
he seemed he had soul. He seemed
yes.
he was a nice human being.
Yes. And I am sorry. I wish he could have gone on with his type show. Much longer.
Uh-huh.
I mean, he was with us for a long time.
Right, right. Times Magazine, you were on the cover of Times.
Yes. Yes.
Tell
Susan
me about
and
that.
I were.
Susan,
well,
your wife.
My wife.
Susan
Seaforth.
Seaforth.
Hayes. Yes.
Days of Our Lives.
Days of Our Lives.
Come on. Days of Our Lives, 14 years.
Yes.
How did you meet your wife, Susan?
On Days of Our Lives.
On the Days of Our Lives?
She started in 1968. Uh-huh. I started on it in 1970.
Uh-huh.
Our characters were put together by Bill Bell, who was then the head writer. He saw some sparks
mm-hmm.
and started to write love scenes for us.
Uh-huh.
A crafty man.
Uh-huh.
And those were very enjoyable.
So you fell in love?
We fell
doing
in love
the scenes?
Doing the scenes, well, at that time anyway.
Uh-huh.
And the whole country watched us fall in love, watched us come to know each other. We became very close friends. We married in 1974.
Uh-huh.
And
you have five children?
I have five children.
You have?
By my first wife, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Not with Susan.
Uh-huh.
We have 11 grandchildren.
11?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
But in the early 70s, we were given wonderful story and the best writing in the world, and
uh-huh.
we just wrote on great stories and writing. The Time magazine did a story about soaps. Early in 1976,
right.
and we were on the cover.
You were on
it.
The cover of Times,
yeah.
both of you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
Susan, where's she from?
She was born in Oakland, raised in Los Angeles.
Uh-huh. And she's been in show business for
since she was a kid.
She was a kid, yes.
She grew up as a daughter of an actress, and so she wouldn't sit in the dressing room, she would do little things.
Bill, is it difficult every day doing scenes and soaps? Isn't it? It's awfully difficult.
I think it is. I think it's...
It's work. It's hard work.
It's very hard work. It all is memorized,
mm-hmm.
so there's a certain amount of mental demand there.
Mm-hmm.
It's done very quickly so that there's also a physical demand. I mean, they do a whole hour, Days of Our Lives, there's a whole hour drama every day. They have about 2 days to write it. You have about 2 days to prepare it as a director, 2 days to prepare it as an actor.
Yes.
And then you're on, and the camera's very close, and it knows.
It knows.
If you don't know,
it tells the truth.
The camera tells the truth.
That's right.
And you better know what you're doing. You know, they talk about soaps would be a wonderful place for a person to
work.
Learn his craft and to break in. Boo.
It isn't?
You better know what you're doing. I mean, the actors that work in soaps are wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
They're
so it's not a working place to work out, like an acting
class.
Well,
you will learn a lot.
You'll learn, yes.
You will learn while you're on it, I guarantee you. But you better know something when you get there.
I see. Because they don't have those cue cards. You don't have to read them all the time. You can't read them all the time.
Read them. They're there for emergency's sake.
Right.
If we're going along and I can't think of a word.
Right.
They're there for me to look over and see the word and return to it. But even if I look over and read off a cue card, the camera knows that, and the people watching know it.
Do you make words up, Bill, sometimes?
You try not to, but once in a while it's necessary. I mean, people, you're human.
Yes.
So you paraphrase a little bit. But if you paraphrase very much, find somebody who will learn the words. Because they pay a lot of money for their words. They want to hear them.
Of course. As the writers do, yes, of course.
And what was the cute film Tootsie that Dustin Hoffman did, where he just began to make up his own story on it? No way.
I understand, Susan, and you are doing a show. It's going to be opening at 42nd Street. You're doing 42nd Street?
Yes.
Look at this. Well, 42nd Street.
We did First Street, then Second Street, and this is Yes, 42nd Street.
Susan Seaforth. I didn't know she sang. She sings.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Does she sing?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
This is like a Broadway a musical.
Oh, it's wonderful.
It's a great show. Bill Hayes and wife together. Wonderful.
Yes.
Going to be opening at in Glendale.
Glendale Music Theater.
The Music Theater. How
Friday.
Wonderful. That's great.
Yes. I played it once before in San Bernardino.
Oh, you did play it?
About 4 years ago.
Uh-huh.
Enjoyed it quite a bit.
It's a tough show, Bill.
Totally different
cast. Isn't
it?
It's a tough show.
Yes, but it's fun.
Is it?
I mean, sure things are work, but if it's fun, then you don't care.
You dance?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
Your wife,
I am not a dancer, but I dance. I've danced in many shows.
Mm-hmm.
I played Charlie and Where's Charlie. I played George M., did a lot of tap dancing.
Did you do George M.?
Yeah.
That's a great show.
Yes. And I've danced in many shows.
Oh, I didn't know that.
And have enjoyed it.
Study singing when you were a young boy?
Not when I was a young boy. When after I got into Carousel, I decided I didn't know much about singing.
In New York?
This is in Chicago.
Chicago.
And I went to Northwestern.
Mm. Great school.
The music school there for about a year and a half until I joined Olson & Johnson.
Oh, you did study,
I studied voice, took a lesson every day and worked very hard at it. And I had a good teacher and stood me instead. The shows are very hard on you. Your voice, as you know, play vaudeville or to do a long, hard musical or straight play.
Has Bill Hayes had a good time when you look back in your career? Would you say you've had a good time?
I must confess, yes.
Yes.
I am thrilled never to have had to go out and try to sell something or dig something or work at some regular job. Uh-huh. I've just had a ball. I enjoy performing.
You would do it the same way right now?
Yes, there are different avenues I would like to have tried or different things. You know, you learn as you go along.
Of course.
And you look back and say, well, there I would have done better to... You know, but
is Bill Hayes religious?
Oh,
spiritual.
Spiritual. I would say spiritual. I grew up in a family that went to church, and I sing in a church choir.
You live here in California.
California. And I enjoy that.
You seem very happy, you and your lovely wife.
Yeah.
And you're working together.
Yes.
You're doing shows together. Yeah. I mean, you're spending a lot of time together.
Yes, and I enjoy that. And I have, as we mentioned before, 5 kids, 11 grandchildren, And those people we just mentioned, that's all my treasure. That's really what counts.
Treasure? What do you mean all those people are your treasure?
My wife.
Your wife?
My children. My grandchildren.
I see.
That's my treasure.
This is what you live for. This
that's
is
right.
your.
That's
that
it.
Is your way of life. That's beautiful. Yeah,
that's the way it is.
So Bill Hayes had a good time in life.
That's right. Still is having a good time. I've had quite a year, Skip.
Like,
I have played Rumors this year, Music Man this year, Sweeney Todd
this year.
This year, 42nd
right.
Street coming up, and following that, I'm going to play Grandpa Vanderhoof in a play called You Can't Take It With You. 1936 Kaufman and Hart play.
Oh, where's that going to be?
That's going to be in North Hollywood, Los Angeles.
So Bill Hayes is keeping himself very, very busy with that soaps and shows and singing. You do a lot of appearances constantly.
Yes, I think
Why do you keep pushing yourself so? Why does Bill Hayes push himself so?
Well,
you look great.
I don't think of it as pushing myself. I just enjoy it. I don't know. That's the nice thing about it.
Showbiz.
I went to a 40-year reunion a few years ago.
Mm-hmm.
People who had been at DePaul University during World War II.
Right.
Men from, I'd say, age 55 to 65, or maybe a little more than that. There were 100 of them. Mm-hmm. I was one of four who had not retired.
Ah.
Since then, I believe the other three have retired.
So you're the only
so
one.
So I'm it.
You are working.
But I'm having too much fun.
And I bet you look the best of all of them. Younger. am I right?
I have a ball.
Yeah.
I mean, what am I going to, if I quit this, what am I going to go to do that's more fun?
Uh-huh.
I don't know. I have to find that.
Do you have a favorite show that you've done?
Ooh, boy.
Is there a favorite
lots.
For Bill Hayes?
I got lots. Oh, my. Carousel, my first show, I finally went on and played Billy Bigelow in Carousel several times, and I think that's just genius, that show. It's just
it is
so beautiful.
Uh-huh. The music is great.
The most fun I ever had on stage was in Where's Charlie?
When you had to get in drag
Once
and all that?
Once in Love with Amy, go back. Uh-huh. It's just a uh-huh. hoot from top to bottom. Uh-huh. Just laughs. The audience uh-huh. just...
They say a straight guy who does that is the best in drag. They
yes.
say a straight guy does the best in drag of Where's Charlie.
You know the show.
I'm very familiar with it.
Okay.
It's a great show.
I have seen people play it
uh-huh.
where they're making fun of the drag bit
right.
when you're playing your own aunt.
Exactly.
And it doesn't work. It's got to be straight.
Of course, of course.
I mean, he uh-huh. just has a dress on, that's
uh-huh.
all.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, it's not funny. Music Man,
uh-huh.
why, what could be more fun than doing, well,
yes.
you got trouble, my friend.
Yes, yes.
Right here, is they troubled right here in River City? Well, sure, I'm a billiard player, certainly mighty proud to say, and on and on and on.
Uh-huh. Bill Hayes,
yes.
Sid Caesar,
yes.
still see him? Friends?
Once in a while, yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes?
Yes.
Do you think of old times when you were together with Sid?
Yes.
And Jean and all those wonderful people?
Yes. And uh-huh. I thought, hey, man, this is for me.
Uh-huh.
I don't want to do a real job.
Uh-huh.
And fortunately, I've never had to.
Olsen and Johnson.
Olsen and Johnson.
Funs and Poppins, or
that's it.
Popsons and Funs?
Funs and Poppins.
Tell me about that. I was in Chicago when that came out, I think. It started in Chicago, didn't it?
Yes, yes. That
it did?
Was 1949. We played Chicago Stadium.
You did?
Yes.
I remember that show,
played
Olsen and Johnson.
Huge arena-type buildings.
Uh-huh.
I was with them for about a year. And we played Madison Square Garden. We played the uh-huh. Indianapolis Coliseum. Just whopper places,
right,
you know.
Right,
instead of
right.
one cow, there'd be six cows or
uh-huh.
whatever. Everything
uh-huh.
was multiplied.
Did you have fun in that show, Olsen and Johnson's? You were very young, you know. I mean, you were a boy singer. You had to do bits, too?
Yes.
Skits and all that?
Yes. All their bits. I was a stooge and a singer, production singer. Certainly, I was getting paid for performing.
Uh-huh.
That was, to me, incredible.
Uh-huh. How did you get Sid Caesar's show? That's the show of all shows.
Your show of shows was the best series ever been on.
On television, yes.
That's right. Well, as I said, I was with Olsen & Johnson for about a year.
Right.
We played nightclubs, we played vaudeville, we played presentation houses. We also did a series of 13 television shows replacing Milton Berle. At that time, Milton Berle was Mr. Television.
Right.
He was the king.
Right.
And we replaced him through the summer of 49.
Right.
Max Liebman saw me on that show and called me and said, would you come? I'm putting a show together. It's going to be called Your Show of Shows. Uh-huh. Would you come sing for my writers and me? And I did. He said, would you come be on our show? And he was only going to pay me about a third as much as I was making on on Olson and Johnson. Olson and Johnson said, you don't want to do that. I mean, we're, you know, Olson and Johnson, we're going to pay you three times that at least. But something told me this was the place to go. It was Show of Shows was the best group of talented people ever
put
together.
Do you remember, Bill Hayes, the song that you did that day for to audition for that show? Do you remember?
Out, there had been run too long and some of the other things, and they came out and said, Mr. Heifetz, sir, excuse me, you're done, that's it, and he's still playing. So from then on, we were the members of the company came in, did the last of the half hour, and many times Charlie Sanford, conducting the orchestra, would hold up his hand and say, hey, we're behind, here we go, and we'd do something very
So it was really
fast.
Tough those days to do a live show with a live audience and millions of people are watching you. You know,
absolutely.
Today it's easy. They tape it.
They tape it, that's right. And
Johnny Carson's taped.
That's
You know.
And if they run an hour and a half plus 5 minutes, all they have to do is just find where they want to cut 5 minutes.
Yeah, right, right.
But we couldn't do that.
Emma Jean Cook.
Yes. Delightful lady.
I love her. Wonderful talent. Yeah. Sid Caesar had some problems on the shows, lots of mental problems at the time when he was doing his show because he was such a genius and such... Am I right, Bill?
Yes, I would say so. He became such a fabulous star so quickly that in his book... which is autobiographical, he's just said he just could not handle it well. I thought he handled it quite well, but apparently in retrospect he went to pills and booze and gave himself a rough time trying to balance his life.
Right.
That he was very emotional about his shows.
He was caring
a show.
Yes.
And had a lot of burden on his shoulders. People today seeing comedy don't realize how fabulously funny those people were. Sid Caesar, Imogene Coca, Carl Reiner, Howard Morris, the four of them were just so brilliant. Plus the writers writing for...
Yeah, the best writers.
Yes. Mel Tolkien, Mel Brooks, Lucille Callan, Tony Webster, they just wrote everything. Mel Brooks. Was not hired by Max Liebman.
Oh, he wasn't?
No. Yes.
Do you remember the... Because that's the song that really... do you remember at all of the song you did?
What I sang for Max Liebman?
I sang.
He said he wanted to hear a ballad, and I didn't know what a ballad was. And I sang some crazy Irish song that I thought was an Irish ballad.
Danny Boy-like or something like that?
It was a Danny Boy type.
But Sid Caesar, working with Sid Caesar, what a great honor.
Such a sweet, charming creature was Kitty O'Toole, the lily of fair Tipperary, with her cheeks like a rose and her eyes like the sloes, and her figure as neat as a fairy. I saw her one day, she looked like a queen, in the glory of sweet 21. She sat with McGinty's big arm round her waist. Be dad, how I envied McGinty. That was the song.
That's
I
the song?
Sang
great.
It was not a ballad, but in my mind then, that was a ballad.
Sid Caesar, working with Sid Caesar, Imogene Coco.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. God, what masters.
Incredible.
Yes.
Sid was a fountain. They both were. I mean, a fountain of creativity.
Right.
Never stopped. Just a continuous fountain. Didn't like it this way, switch the gear one notch, play it a totally different way, just as funny, just as creatively. Don't like that? Okay, switch it again, do it a different way. Fabulous.
But you had a live audience out there.
Yes, we did.
That show was live.
Yes, it was live. It was all live.
All 90 minutes
every week, every Saturday night. It was all live. We did play to an audience of about 350. And because it was live, many things happened you know, live television.
Like,
it just...
Yeah.
Well, on our very first show, we had Yasha Heifetz as a guest star.
Right.
And they made... Unfortunately, they put him at the end of a half hour.
Right.
And NBC had said to us, now you can go 9 to 9:30, but you got to stop exactly at 9:30.
Right.
And take a break. Then you can go 9 to 10, 9:30 to 10, and you have to take a break exactly at 10.
Uh-huh.
And another one exactly at, you're off at 10:30.
Right.
Okay. Well, they put him right at the end. They made him the last act of the first half hour.
Uh-huh.
And I can never forget the look on his face when the stage manager came.
Honor of singing an aria from Pagliacci, a mere Shen Bedlam in Madison Square Garden. Better known facts about him are that he starred on Days of Our Life for 14 years, was a regular on the legendary A Show of Shows, and had the hit recording of Davy Crockett. He is, of course, the popular Bill Hayes. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Lowe.
Bill Hayes, June 5th.
June 5th, that's
it. Harvey, Illinois.
Harvey, Illinois.
Great place to come
yes.
from. Illinois.
Illinois.
Outside of Chicago?
Yes. Lou Boudreau grew up right across the street. Tom Dreesen's from
uh-huh.
Harvey.
Uh-huh.
Small town, but it's a suburb of Chicago.
Tell me, when did Bill Hayes decide to become a singer? At what age?
Well, Bill Hayes grew up singing.
Really?
I mean, I was in a musical family, and we sang all the time.
Uh-huh. Either
around the piano, or in the shower, or anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
We just sang all the time. So singing was a part of my life. I played fiddle through high school, played pretty nice fiddle.
Uh-huh.
Learned good musicianship there.
Uh-huh.
But I never knew that you could make any money singing. It never occurred to me. I mean, singing was what we did for fun,
uh-huh.
and acting for fun. And when I finally, I graduated from college in 1947, and I fell into a job singing and acting in the chorus of Carousel,
uh-huh.
Chicago, Schubert Theater,
mm-hmm.
and getting paid $60 a week.
Max
thought Mel was trashy.
Right.
No, not enough class. Well, Sid brought him in,
uh-huh.
and Sid says, he's funny, Max, he writes funny. So Max says, well, you pay him. So
uh-huh.
Sid brought Mel Brooks in.
Is that what
to
happened?
Start. And of course, Mel was wonderfully creative. He used to write all the monologues that Sid used to do, you know, when he played a gum machine and
uh-huh.
a fly on the wall uh-huh. and a little uh-huh. baby. Mel would write those.
Remember the Jack Parr days?
Certainly.
Those were the days.
Yes.
You have appeared on that show many times.
I appeared on the Jack Parr
Tell
show.
Tell me about Jack Parr, though, Bill. I mean, a lot of people really don't know Jack Parr, but I guarantee you do. Tell me about Jack Parr.
Well, he's a very unique talent, certainly. He was a very real person,
mm-hmm.
and what he thought, he could not conceal. It just
that's what it was.
Came
when you saw Jack Parr, you saw
him.
It.
That's right. He was not a fake in any way.
So when he cried, he actually...
He cried.
He meant it.
When he laughed, it was not a put-on. He just had conversations with his people.
Uh-huh.
I one show I did with him, his guest was Errol Flynn.
Uh-huh.
And Errol Flynn had just been down fighting on Castro's side.
I remember that, yes.
And he was very moving, and Jack Parr was quite moved by Errol Flynn's statements,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
the things that he believed in. Mm-hmm. He suddenly realized that Errol Flynn was not just an actor, but a
thinker, human being,
a believer and a human being.
Uh-huh.
That show, if you happen to remember that show, that was Phyllis Diller's first performance.
Was that Phyllis's first performance?
Yep.
She came from the village at the...
That's right.
She was working at the Bossois.
Devon
that's
Swann.
Right. Is that right?
And she, that's right.
I do remember that.
She didn't even have any costumes yet. She was she just wore a
housewife,
a black leotard with a top, kind of like what you have, and she was just housewife, just starting.
And the audience took for her then.
Yes, yes.
She became just an overnight success.
A wonderful
Jeff Carr really made a lot of stars, didn't he?
Yes, Genevieve.
Genevieve. Yeah. Yes, you're absolutely right. Getting back to